We've done something so unique. We've convinced more than 1,000 great big companies to put their financial data into our private cloud. And whatever comes our way, yeah, darling, go make it happen. Take the world in a loving place. Buy all of your guns and pumps and explode into space. I like smoking lightning. Heavy metal thunder, racing with the wind, and the feeling that I'm under. Yeah, darling. We were the ones to pioneer this market in the first place, and we're not just sitting around, we're continuing to innovate. So from my view, no, we don't have a lot of competition.
Please welcome Therese Tucker, CEO of Blackline.
Good morning, and thank you so much. What a great conference, right? I mean, I've spent my whole career in B2B software, and it's an area that doesn't get enough focus. So today I'm going to start by telling you a little bit about me and a little bit about Blackline and then some of the things that I've learned along the way. I am the youngest of four girls, and I was raised on a farm in rural Illinois. And neither of my parents went to college, and their big dream for me was that I could be a secretary, okay? And they made me take typing in high school, which worked out really well when I majored in computer science, all right? I've also always had trouble conforming, fitting into a certain mold, which might explain the pink hair, which you may be wondering about, so we'll just dispense with that right away. It happened 3 years ago. My marketing team wanted me to do the world's most boring video. You know, older woman, a blah, 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 right? And I kept saying, no, I don't wanna, and I finally said, fine, I'll do it, but I'm gonna dye my hair pink. And they laughed and they said, no, you won't. And they didn't realize that I really try to never lose a game of chicken, okay? Turned out I liked it. Turned out it became sort of who I am. But I'm also a serial entrepreneur. And I retired from Sungard Treasury Systems as their CTO. And I got bored and started Blackline. Not the best reason for starting a company, right? Bootstrapped, because nobody in their right mind would have actually invested in us back then. And took it up until 2014 as a bootstrapped company. Now, later in this talk, I'm going to give you a couple of my horror stories about fundraising along the way. So I want to put a caveat on that. In 2014, I sold a majority to Silver Lake Sumeru and Iconic. And when you find the right partner, the right investor, what they can do in terms of helping you grow and scale a company is just invaluable. So when I tell you horror stories later, just keep that in mind, okay? Bootstrapped it, and then in October of 2016, we actually did an IPO, which was interesting and fun and kind of cool, all right? But it's a lot of work, too. So what is it that we do, you ask? Well, let me ask you, how much do you know about accounting? And all of a sudden, you're sorry that you asked. Because accounting is probably the least sexy field out there. And yet, there's a point to that, because sometimes the best businesses are the areas that other people have overlooked because they're not terribly interesting. All right, and what we've been able to do is we've been able to build this very cool business. We've got an army of happy customers, and we've gotten just enough publicity that I get to be up here and speak to you today. All right, but in the 16 plus years that I've actually been working at Blackline, the culture has shifted dramatically. We have gone through this myth-making process where we've deified founders as these brilliant geniuses, okay? And yet that really sharply diverges from my own set of experiences and the things that I've learned along the way. And so today, I want to tell you about some of the myths that I see out there and some of the sort of how I view some of the different experiences that I've had. All right? Up. There we go. Myth number one. There's a playbook. I've heard that word a few times around here already. All right? There's an old adage out there. If it was easy, everybody would do it. All right? This applies here. If there was a playbook that worked for everybody, then everybody would go out and make a gazillion dollars and we'd all be happy. But it's not like that. Companies are like people. They have a unique DNA. They have a unique culture. What might work beautifully for one can absolutely sink another. So those that are most likely to succeed, sometimes they fail. And sometimes those that everybody else overlooks are the ones that succeed and quietly, all right? And when you start a company, you're betting on an idea or vision that nobody else has had, all right? I mean, when you start a company, do you ever ask yourself, why didn't IBM or Google or Oracle do this? Well, there's two answers for that. Either they really did overlook it, or they actually looked at it and valued it differently than you did, okay? And so when you're starting a company, it's really just a bet that everybody else is wrong and they made a mistake. So if somebody tells you there's one way of doing it, they're guessing. They are. So the playbook, I have a bit of a playbook now, all right? But it's my playbook. It worked for Blackline, all right? The truth is, when you start a company, to take it to a successful place, it's a weird mix of, you know, hard work, perseverance, luck. Sometimes it's just having a friend who encourages you when you are ready to quit. It can be something that small as having the right person say the right thing into your life at the right time. And so my caveat for today is I'm going to share some of my experiences with you, but they may or may not work. They may or may not be helpful to what you're doing. So myth number two, in Los Angeles, there's where I live, there's this guy. Oh my gosh, you can run into him all the time. He will tell you if you ask him what he does, he'll tell you that he's in the business. All right, for those of you that don't know Southern California, that's the movie business, Hollywood, all right? And if you press him further, he'll tell you that he's working on his screenplay. And then he'll keep telling you, he won't stop talking. He'll tell you that Brad Pitt's gonna star in his pilot, and he's got so-and-so to produce it, and Hans Zimmer to do the music, and you just know that this guy is full of it, and you're trying to be polite, and you're trying to get away, okay? We see that guy all the time down in LA. Don't be that guy with your startup. Don't be that guy, all right? Now, the reality is to even get to the point where you quit your day job and you're gonna go start a company, you have to have a stupid amount of confidence. All right, you do. You just have to go, I don't care what everybody else says, I know I can do this, all right? And it's almost an arrogant choice to say that I'm right and everybody else in the world is wrong because they didn't see it. That's how good I am, all right? So it is, there has to be a certain amount of confidence that actually gets you to that point where you jump off that cliff, all right? But the biggest mistakes happen when people start to believe their own hype, all right? When they start to think, you know, we have a saying in-house at Blackline, somebody always says, all that in a bag of chips, right? You have people that think that they're all that. And when that happens, they lose focus on the business itself. But the reality is different. If you are the CEO of a small company, you have to be committed to doing whatever it takes to make that company successful. Now, that could be buying bagels, that could be coding. I've cleaned toilets, not fun, okay? But in one of our offices, we didn't have a cleaning service, so yeah, it got gross, I did it. And because I wanted my company to succeed no matter what, all right? So you have to do all of that while you are selling all the time, while you are cheerleading, and while you are dealing with the stress of whether or not it's gonna work, all right? The glamour might come later. Might come much, much, much later. So don't be that guy, all right? Don't be that guy. Instead, if you pivot from arrogance to humility, all right, there are so many benefits here. It allows you to be confident in your idea, but still seek out the wisdom of people who have been there before. And I will always be indebted to one of my early board members and friends, Tom Unterman. I would bring all of my documents to lunch and lay out everything to give a snapshot of the business. And he would, time after time, point to an area that I had completely missed. And I'd go, oh my God, how did I miss that? And he'd say, you need to focus on that before it becomes a huge problem. Cannot put a price on that. The ability to seek wisdom from others, all right? And the other thing about humility, it gives you clarity. It gives you clarity to look at your business honestly and assess what's working and what's not, okay? Blackline started out by building wealth management software. I knew how to do that. I was great at it. After 3 years, we had one paying customer, okay? Out of money, terribly broke, freaked out. This customer came to us and it went something like this. We have a business problem. We don't have any engineers. We have money. I said, you have engineers. You obviously don't have any money. What if we trade? Okay. But think about this. My big idea, optimizing accounting operations, was not my big idea. How embarrassing is that? It was created by an accountant at a bank in Nebraska. I'm not kidding, okay? So humility allows you to do the pivots, allows you to capitalize on a great idea no matter whose idea it is. But if you're married to your own idea and it's not the right one, it's not gonna work. So it's interesting in that humility can be an attribute, while not really prized in the tech industry, can really allow you to be successful. So remember our aspiring screenwriter, right? One of the reasons that he is so annoying is because he's got it in his mind that his future is all about riches and yachts and very exclusive Hollywood parties. He's not necessarily interested in putting in the work that's necessary or getting the coaching or the feedback that he needs. And we've all seen it, all right? But the reality is most startups fail, okay? Most do. Even Blackline, it wasn't my first attempt, all right? And there were any number of times when I was really convinced that it was a dead proposition. All right? We failed almost many times. But even after we did our pivot to the accounting automation and optimization, we still had desperate moments. One of the things that was so interesting to me was doing business with large companies. They move at a glacial pace, okay? We would have sometimes 3 to 5 year sales cycles. I'm not kidding. And then they would call up and go, guess what? You're selected. We're going to introduce you and two competitors to our procurement department. Okay. Absolutely. And then even if you get the software in and they love it, sometimes they take 3 or 4 months to pay. And that would keep me up at night trying to figure out how I was going to make my payroll. All right? So even when you're successful, it's a long road. And it's not, I mean, think about Blackline, 15 years from inception to IPO. All right? And it's kind of like, when I think about building this company, I think about sort of, and I hate bugs and I hate jungles. I think about trying to make a road through the jungle, all right? There's no road, there's no path, there's no map. There's no straight line. You don't quite know where you're going. You're sort of zigzagging back and forth, all right? And you have to, it's a long, slow haul, and you have to learn things like, how do I scale my sales force? How do we sell to accountants? How do we market? How do we handle the security around financial information? The things that we had to learn were not something that I could go Google on the internet, all right? And, you know, it was particularly tough because when you're bootstrapped, every single dollar matters. When you make a mistake, that's a dollar that you don't have anymore, all right? And so, in fact, one of our decisions in 2007, we had to decide, are we going to sell SaaS or are we going to be an on-prem software company? Terrifying, because back in those days, big companies didn't even know what SaaS was, much less they weren't going to put their financial information out in the cloud. And we decided at that point to bite the bullet and say, everything we're going to do, whether it's how we architect the software, how we go to market, how we actually contract, everything is SaaS from here on out. That was a terrifying decision. And yet, it turned out to be a very, very good one. Could have gone the other way, right? You hit points like that in your journey where it's like, wow, fork in the road, flip a coin, I hope we're doing the right thing, okay? And you can't really call those out ahead of time. They just kind of spring up and hit you at times. So if you get to be successful, it will probably take longer than you really, really wanted it to. I thought when I started Blackline, I thought it would take about 3 years. That was really my expectation. And you will hit things that you don't anticipate, but this is your story. This is really about what you craft for your own journey. So let me be really clear here. I'm not advocating not raising capital. Okay, they've probably kicked me off the stage right now. VC money definitely is what makes tech companies happen, all right? But bootstrapping is brutally hard. It is so many sleepless nights. There are no shortcuts. It's a day-to-day fight for survival, all right? We did look at funding on multiple occasions. We had some low-ball offers from names that you would recognize that we turned down, all right? But I believe that the habits that we learned from bootstrapping Blackline in terms of just being wise about how you spend money really were very instrumental in our success later. I would say avoid building your business with the intent of raising money. We see people sometimes, they're all about their business plan, okay? They're about how many meetings they can get. They're about who they're talking to. Oh my gosh, sometimes you walk around the streets of San Francisco and people are on their phones bellowing out that their plans are getting funded. And you're just like, oh no. You know, you're losing the focus on the business when you do that. You're falling in love with the idea, and it's easy to do because the money is what sustains your business, okay? But the person on the other side doesn't know your market and doesn't know your business, all right? And focusing on impressing them over building your business, all right, or getting customers, that's dangerous. And frankly, we got some bad advice from VCs in the early days. I had one firm who sort of gave me the proverbial pat on the head and said, you've done a nice job, we'll take it from here, okay? And they said, we've got a rock star CEO. So I thought, well, all right, maybe this is good for the company, I'll meet him. Met this gentleman, he spent 2 hours talking about himself, how great he was, his much younger, very beautiful second wife, and his home renovation project. He was almost a caricature of himself, all right? Had I taken that advice, I doubt, and money, I doubt that Blackline would be here today. Venture capitalists are playing a numbers game. If they can take 10 companies of a similar profile, there's a pretty good chance that one of those is going to be really successful and make back the investment, which is great if you're the one. But if you're not, you may not be aligned. Okay? So rather than focus so much on the raising of capital, and sometimes, you know, well, I won't say anything political, but we have people that can't stop campaigning, right? It's a similar issue. You don't want to be the guy who's always just not building a business, but trying to raise money. One of the most important predictors of success of a company is if people want to pay for what you're doing. It sounds so simple and so obvious, and yet sometimes people don't really focus on that. So my recommendation is to take the smallest amount of capital possible and retain the most control, all right? And if you build a successful business that has paying customers, a clean ledger, a thrifty attitude, you will be able to raise as much money as you need when you need it. Now, something else to be careful of is when you raise money, people sometimes have a tendency to spend like they're rich, all right? And I always think about lottery winners. Do you know, most lottery winners are broke within 3 years of winning, all right? Because they just start throwing money around. And it's possible, all right, I suppose, to plow large amounts of money efficiently into your startup. But it's not that common. Usually people end up wasting it. And it is much more painful to have to fire people and contract as a company than it is to grow. It's much more fun to grow. It's much more fun to have a little bit of a stretch and a bit of a reach. So build a real business with paying customers. Run it lean, all right? And you will be amazed at the amount of money that will be there when it's the right time to scale. Big money, your big money is going to go into hiring your employees. And there's a fundamental difference between the people that start companies and the people who really like their paycheck, all right? Now, the best people, the A players, I'm sorry to tell you this, they already work for really cool companies and make a lot of money, okay? Early days at Blackline, there's no way we could have afforded those people, all right? And so, probably you've heard before the project management triangle, all right? Cheap, faster, good. Pick two, all right? This is my version of this. And hiring people at a startup is pretty darn similar, all right? So think about this paradigm here, all right? If you go with good, but they're not cheap, all right, guess what? You're going to run out of money. If you go with cheap and not crazy, your product is going to suffer, okay? So we went with the crazy, and okay. There is a television show that lampoons Silicon Valley, right? But there's a difference here. The crazy in that group is kind of a fun crazy. They're engaging. They're like, oh, that's really fun and interesting crazy. Now, there's crazy crazy, all right? We had a guy that I had to let go, and, you know, afterwards, some of the other guys in the company came up to me and said, thank you. Every time he used the restroom, nobody could go in there for like a week. I'm like, oh, okay. We had people who had mental breakdowns. We had alcohol abuse. We had prescription drug addiction. How about that person passed out on their desk regularly? Okay. We had people that would scream at other people, kind of frothing on their face, all right? Not all of them were like that, okay? Some just needed a coach, all right? Some needed talent development. And that's something that as a founder and an entrepreneur, you need to get your arms around. Because what we were able to do is we brought on people that frankly weren't qualified for the jobs. My first engineer was a guy who had not yet finished his coding class, all right? My first marketing guy was a guy whose previous job was selling awnings. Yes, awnings for houses. Okay, he was fabulous. He's still with the company. So, and the first engineer is also still there, all right? First salesperson had never sold software before. He's top performer now. So with the right amount of talent development, you can find people that are willing to take a chance with you for the chance to grow. And they're not entrepreneurs, they're just people that want the opportunity. So, let's go back to my early days. Is it surprising that I couldn't get a fair valuation early on? Well, let's recap. Old. Old is like a bad word in tech. Female. Single mother. You can almost hear the VCs running out of the room. Yeah. I had somebody ask me, is your husband involved in the company? I was divorced at the time. Yeah. The truth is women receive less than 2% of all VC funding. There is a persistent wage gap, and there are persistently statistically flawed reasons for that. One of the most damaging myths that women buy into is that they somehow are not able to have a family and have a great career, all right? Be a mother and be a career person, all right? Now that might close some doors, all right? But that's not through your own fault. That's because we live in a weird world, all right? But there is no reason that you cannot be a mother, all right? Or an involved father, for that matter. Sorry, I don't mean to leave the gentleman out of this paradigm. And build a successful company, all right? You will be stronger for it. So, I was a mother. I still am. Being a mom made me a better CEO. Because in the beginning, if you kind of go back to the crazy, all right, everybody brings you their stuff. And you have to be able to essentially be their parent sometimes, all right? We had a bit of everything going on. We had a motley crew of people. We'd have career anxiety, you know? And you have to take care of all of those issues that people bring you before you even start to deal with your own stress and anxiety about whether or not this thing that you've poured your life savings into is actually gonna make it, all right? And if I had not been a parent, I don't know how I would have handled that, all right? The company itself, it's like a kid, all right? You can't leave it alone for like 2 seconds or it just goes right off the track, all right? It goes through stages. You know, I sometimes look at Blackline and I feel like I'm about out of college now, all right? But I've watched the parallels as you go. It's really something that is a labor of love, all right? And you will sacrifice more if you want to do something like have both, all right? In my early days at Blackline, I had a very narrow life. I had my company and I had my kids. All right. If I had friends, either those friendships withered or I hired them for almost nothing to come work for Blackline. It's the only way I could do it. All right. There were times when I was so burnt out, I felt so alone, all right, and it was so difficult, but you know what? I could go home at the end of the day and be mom. And that was a really special balance because my kids didn't care if I was successful or not. I was just their mom, and it was a beautiful thing, all right? And so starting a company also made me a better parent. I allowed myself flexibility to go to their football games, their soccer games, their Halloween parades. I might follow that up by working all night, but I was able to flex it in a way that really allowed me to be there when my kids needed me, all right? And so being a mom to a company is actually incredibly rewarding. I have had so many employees that, you know, they started and they were surfers and bicyclists and everything else, and now they show me pictures of their houses, kids, family, dogs, right? It's the whole thing. They've grown up through the years, and it's been this amazing journey. You know, I make a point to find and hire women. I don't judge people if they need flexibility as long as they're getting their work done, all right? I know that I will be getting someone who is a problem solver, who is a collaborative multitasker, okay? I know that there's somebody, if they're a mother, they can adapt to anything that life throws them, all right? The tech industry undervalues women across so many roles, all right? And this is a challenge for this group in general, but it's also an opportunity. It's a tight labor market right now, okay? And I've had tremendous success. In fact, about half of my C-suite right now is women, all right? Which is unbelievable, right? In a tech company. I'm proud of that. But if you value someone in a market that doesn't value them, you have the ability to acquire a fantastic asset that maybe you couldn't have gotten otherwise because of competition, all right? And if you pay them what they're actually worth, oh my God, they're so appreciative and loyal, all right? So this is one of those fun cases where you can actually do the right thing as a company and reap the benefits from it. All right. So, people always ask me for my advice to entrepreneurs, and I say, don't do it. Don't do it. And they're sort of puzzled by that. And my view is that if you take my advice, you never would have made it anyway, okay? But if you shrug it off and you go, yeah, what does she know? All right, you might be an entrepreneur. And you might have the absolute best or the absolute worst, probably both, journey in front of you. But even if it's the worst, it won't be boring, okay? You are going to learn and learn and learn even when you're discouraged and down. And you're gonna laugh and you're gonna cry and you're gonna live to the fullest. I view being an entrepreneur as like the ultimate in the American dream, okay? And you might have the opportunity to build something that is sustainable, something that is a thing by itself that is outside of you, that other people claim and love and get rewards from, okay? And for me, that's pretty much everything. So thank you.